people walking about, looking in shop windows, trying to cross the road. Colourful shops, dismal shops, gay shops, folk buying food. Litter flying about, dirty streets with dull grey houses, shabby hedges in the garden, gardens dirty, forgotten land, chimneys smoking, bricks dirty and drab.
Down the street, people shopping, oil spills on the road, cars going past, splashing you up your legs, houses still standing, staring at you.
Nine-year-old children went out with their teacher into the street outside their school. It's amazing how much children can find to interest them, even on a cold January day. There are stones and gravel to be picked up from the pavement. And oil stains where a car has stood.
There doesn't seem to be any dull colour.
I wonder why the phone call is not just dull marks.
There are bits and pieces from the surface of the road. And then there are the telegraph poles. How tall they are and thick. What are these numbers? And look, the wire. There are mosses growing in the wall.
There's a tree up there, and it's hollow, and it's got fungi in it, I think.
The children touch. And look. And learn. It was the fruit shop which started them thinking. They went in with 2 shillings from the teacher to spend. These girls looked down at the covers on the ground. And discovered there was no regular distance between them. Martin and Nicky looked up at the lampstand. These, then, were the starting point. And the teacher had to revise his plan. Children quickly got to work on their various interests. Stephen and Michael joined the girls in the study of fruit. Cutting, looking, touching, counting, tasting. Others painted pictures of the mosses. out in the frost in the playground. Of course, the frosty playground had its other uses. Two children had changed groups, but the main lines of inquiry were becoming clear. Stephen asked if the peel of a grapefruit was waterproof. He weighed one before and after soaking, and as the weights he had weren't fine enough, he used washers instead. Went mouldy, so he gave it to the group interested in fungi. They looked at it, and then tried to find how deep the mould went. And whether it affected the juice. Meanwhile, Martin and Nicky made models of the lamp standards they'd seen, from materials available in the classroom. While Christine and Lynn, who had found a little rivulet of water and sand on the drive, decided to separate the sand by filtering. To reproduce the colour patterns they had seen on the road. The search for mosses continued. There were lots of them, different coloured ones in different places. The girls thought there might be a connection between the kind of tree bark and the moss that grew on it, and they wondered if different mosses might grow at the top and the bottom of the tree. More colour patterns were found in bubbles. Nicholas filled the room with the smell of tar when he made his own road surface from materials he had scrounged from a local builder. On the darkened landing, the colour group, who had read that they could split white light into colours, tried it for themselves. Robert, who had not been deeply involved before, became their leader. One interesting side issue came from speed problems in mathematics, which sent some of the children back to the street. return to their classroom pets.
Well, can't we make use of the wheel in some way?
You can make a mark on it with some chalk or something and see how fast it went round in a second.
What would we have to work out from there?
See how far it would take to do 1 mile.
So in some way you'd have to find out the distance around the edge of the wheel, the circumference of the wheel, wouldn't you? Put a chalk mark on it. And?
Start the stop clock when it goes in. Count how many times to get to the bottom and when it comes round again, count it one time.
The children developed their main topics. Model telegraph poles led to Morse messages and books about telephones. The moss group made a garden in a swift jar. Stephen and his friends numbered the compartments of their fruits and then planted seeds from them. Filtered deposits from various household commodities fascinated Christine and Lynn. And the cement mixers devised an experiment to test the strength of their product. The mystery of what lay under the drain covers was partly solved when someone came into school one day and reported a hole in the road. The class went out to see. Nicholas discovered what lay beneath the surface of the road and quickly gathered some samples. The men were scouring the water main. The foreman was helpful. He showed the children how to tap a hydrant and how to measure the flow and pressure of the water. The teacher set up a display in the classroom, but Jean was the only one who wanted to measure the pipes. studying cement, discovered its components were limestone and clay and ground these to make their own cement. When it was mixed, they tested it.
I looked through the microscope at a sort of dry mix of sand and cement, and you can just see a sort of grey background, that's the cement, and the sand crystals on it.
The fungi group became concerned with food preservation. They tried the effect of cooking. Groups tried spinning tops as a way of mixing. Ruth became fascinated by the lamps used for filming and temporarily abandoned her mosses. Some others took time off to read stories. But the Morse group signaled gaily across the busy classroom. And the colour group improved their method.
After a bit, we wondered what the colours made all mixed together. Well, we mixed them in paint. Then we got the grindstone and mixed the colours like that. They seemed to go colours that we didn't expect them to. But red and yellow just made yellow instead of orange.
Meanwhile, some of the filtrates had produced crystals which started Lynn on new investigations. Nicholas got hold of some brick clay to make his road section. Jean used some to make her model pipes. The moss garden had produced condensation and the girls investigated its properties. Martin and Nicky, with a lot of new assistants, wired up their lamps. Stories of famous messages which had been read to them by the teacher inspired some girls to make needlework pictures. John and Andrew, from the cement group, wanted to make sandpaper. They decided the paper must be strong and water resistant. First, they devised a strength test. Thank you. water get into the water main? A class discussion prepared the way for a visit to the reservoir. An infection tunnel which ran along the bottom of the dam.
Going down the iron ladder, suddenly everything is blacked out. Slowly and gently down the steps and holding on tight. Then out into the light. It was great to see light again, and behold, there was the reservoir. 65 feet of drinking water and 51 million gallons was in there.
Why is the water blue? Why not any other colour? It could be the sky.
But I don't know about the sky because in puddles it doesn't look like that, does it?
To the reservoir did three things. It answered some questions arising from the study of the streets, it started off new ideas, and it gave some new slants to old ones. Some boys built a model of a dam. Stephen and Michael, who have been studying fruits, have picked up some insect galls on the visit and set about finding what caused them. Interested in the graph from the flow meter at the reservoir.
1,500 gallons, and then it went quite rapidly up to around 10 o'clock and it became 36,000 gallons.
Christine and Lynn had been surprised to learn that sand could be used to filter water and decided to try it. The sandpaper boys stuck doggedly to their original theme and tested out papers for water absorption. Nicholas was still on ropes. Temperature measurement had linked up with condensation and the moss garden. Working naturally, yet scientifically, independently, yet cooperatively, with the teacher helping the children to isolate their own problems, plan their own experiments, and feed meaning into their observations. He has provided books and materials, trying to anticipate the children's needs. He has encouraged them to communicate what they have discovered. Using science as a tool with which to educate children. For children are people. They grow into tomorrow only as they live today.